probably the best stakeholder type group that I've ever worked with at the state, so, I mean, people are positive and energetic and solution focused, and I mean, I just thank you. I mean, I thank people anyway for taking their time out, this has been a really good group. We're gonna...
Thank you.
We got minutes out this time, right? Were they all okay, were there comments?
Yeah, the one on the, it was interesting, on the stakeholder input on the, parent supplies. I would say that this was a very impressive group to give appropriate feedback almost immediately.
And I think he heard it loud and clear, so.
It was convincing feedback.
And nobody lynched him, so thank you for that.
It helped school that you added 2 minutes, which was helpful, because it had gotten into a stir that continued to percolate out there in the world. So it was helpful having it in writing.
Good, okay.
I think there may be a typo in the respite staff qualifications.
Is that that, Renee?
Yes.
Number two.
Okay.
Take a look at it. It says at least 1 year old.
Please.
Is this the person providing the respite?
Yes.
Yeah, I would want it.
I want a middle one though.
That's probably a legend that needs to be added there somewhere.
So what's the second number you're suggesting?
What did we come up with, 18?
Yeah. Any other comments?
Just thank Bruce for, I know you guys do that just to see if we're really reading them. Thanks, Bruce.
He's very, I don't know if you guys see the stuff that you don't actually, I know he's very good with writing skills. I'm not good with English skills, but he's been very talented. So then we'll move on. To the next agenda item. One thing I'm getting, so Monica's going to go through some information here, but one of the things I'm going to ask both her and Kenneth to do is to tell you what else is coming your way that will be labor related, just to give you an idea of where we're at. Because I think we're coming up to the end. Not necessarily, I mean, there's going to be post-waiver writing activities that we're going to have to discuss, but what we're going to have to discuss to put in the waiver so that Deb can finish getting her template out, we're just about there. So if you could just give that overview, that would be helpful. And also, I mean, I know you have a few things that will be post, so give an idea of that too.
Okay. All right, good afternoon, everybody. So I guess I'll go ahead and do that first before I jump into the PowerPoint. So you have two of our deliverables today, which are the competencies, recommended competencies, and the SID policy for ISP planning. The other document that we're working on is the risk assessment portion, attachment E is what it is in the policy for risk assessments of SIS. We are also going to add some language in about addendums, and this is when there only needs to be a few changes made, corrections made to the SIS. The person doesn't require a full reassessment, so we're still working on that. We're also looking at some care coordination performance measures. The group is continuing to work through that. And I think those are the only two things that we're working on past these drafts here. Okay. So we'll go ahead and get started. And
did you have questions about that? No.
No, I
have. I didn't think you had a question.
Yeah, I did. I was just looking back at the service definitions. Are you
Kenneth will get to that.
I lost track of it.
Okay.
You're not over that. Okay. That's why I wasn't sure I knew that.
Okay. So, because we have limited time, I have a presentation. Kenneth has presentations, and I really hate when people just read slides. We have 32 pages, so we decided to divide them up between myself and Lisa. I'll take the first half, and she'll jump in for the second half. And we have our trusty clicker, Maya. Everyone has a part. So this, the care coordination work group was charged with coming up with IDD care coordination recommended competencies. And this was basically a way to, for you to know what knowledge your care coordinator has, what training they've received in working with an individual. So we just started out saying these guidelines are recommended competencies. They're expected, care coordinators are expected to know the policies and procedures from the MCO, and they are expected to know the clinical coverage policy AP, which covers the innovations waiver. So just an overview of their roles. I think one of the most important roles of the care coordinator is education, and that's education for the individual, the families, and mainly explaining to them what their role is. Again, as we move from case management to care coordination, people really didn't understand what the care coordinator was expected to do. So one of those things is to fully explain what their role is. Okay. Also provide technical assistance, educate families or legal responsible persons on provider choice. They can give information on the MCO's customer service line and also other the clinical policies within the MCO. Okay. The care coordinator, you want that care coordinator to continuously look within the community to see what resources are available in the community. If need be, that person will be linked to a community guide. If that is the need, report all complaints and grievances. And then in the absence of your care coordinator should arrange for a backup, that things will go on in their absence, especially if it's an extended absence. And if it's unplanned, then that's when the supervisor. There should always be someone that you can contact. If your care coordinator is out, it's not an excuse that things don't get done. Okay, so the care coordinator should report gaps in services to their supervisor. And another thing care coordinators should do,
I'm sorry, going back to that last one, the bottom page ranges for the backup care coordination. How is that going to be communicated? For example, the people who may need to know that would be obviously the family and the provider. So that needs to be communicated that this person's gone or in the absence of this person, being able to reach them, and you should contact the supervisor at such and such number. That needs to be communicated to you.
Right. So if you're saying if it's unplanned, if they just left abruptly or abruptly, or if they had an accident and just couldn't come to work again, then that should be, I would think, on the supervisor. And the MCOs can jump in here at any moment. But I think that would be on the supervisor. And I think even going in, initially meeting with the family, that should already be laid out. You know, if you're unable to contact me, this is who you would contact.
That needs to be part of the process.
Yes. Okay, any other questions? Okay, and again, I think I was down to seek clinical supervision when questions arise outside of their scope of practice. So again, just meeting with that supervisor on a regular basis. Especially when, you know, something is asked of the care coordination, because none of us know everything. You know, an answer, well, except Kathy. But, you know, our answer should never be, I don't know. It could be, I don't know, but I'll get back to you. But we shouldn't leave it as, I don't know. Another competency, person-centered thinking. This is, you know, focusing on strengths and interests of individuals. This is where we use that person-first language. They use a friendly language with all communication. And in conjunction with that is person-centered planning. And the one thing I want to remind everybody about person-centered planning is not one single meeting. This is an ongoing process. It should be an ongoing process. Okay, then we get into some ISP development. This is for our next three slides.
Back up for a quick second.
Yes.
Person-centered thinking and planning. So I know kind of where that sits and where the responsibility for that's been changing a bit. So, and I get the reason we need to make sure folks are really versed in the understanding of those the values for one and what that really means by techniques as well. And I would infer that so that if the care coordinator is receiving it, they'll really know what to look for, or are we seeing, just remind me, are we seeing an increased role in the person-centered thinking and planning process by the care coordinator as a lead facilitator?
I would think yes. I mean, if we're saying this is one of your competencies, then you're going to expect it, you're expected to know this, and not just know it, but kind of follow through with that process. So I think for some of this, I think, you know, we gathered this information, and if you're not seeing it now, this is what we're saying as we move forward. And I feel like I'm going a little bit fast, so if I am, just slow me down. Yes.
Kind of building on one of the points that Chris was making, and this is as close as it came in the document when it talked about demonstrating competencies. This whole document. How will these competencies be demonstrated? Meaning, will there be a test? Will they be certified as a care coordinator? What would be their, there's just variability in this as it's implemented across the state currently. So this go round, let's try to fix some of those things so that they are, so there's a standard expectation set of performance. So they would, I'm hoping, be some kind of demonstrated competency test, whatever, so that they're certified. And then any areas of deficiency or weakness, because, you know, you're talking about young people, right? Some people are going to be right out of school, going to be doing this, they're going to be studying this. And so there needs to be a supervision plan, just like there would be with a provider, where you hire someone who doesn't meet the standard, but you recognize that they have additional training that's needed to be done. And what is the accountability system that assures that they then get that training? What's happening right now in the real world is sometimes a care coordinator comes out, reviews services, and, you know, I was young at one time. I had dark hair at one point. So, what's happening is that sometimes you would have a very experienced, decades-long person that really knows what's happening, or parent, and a care coordinator who's young at it, and really is not at a high level of competence yet, tries to be the expert to this person. And it doesn't really go very well. And I mean, but that's the way our system is, right? You've got to get people trained. And but anyway, we need to start with what are the demonstrated competences, how we're going to measure them, what is the supervision plan that that we're going to make sure that they get that training in deficit areas that they need.
Well, in regards to a test, I'm not sure there's going to be a test. But as far as supervision plans, I would hope that's already occurring.
required to standardize it.
Yeah.
Some kind of way.
Yeah, I guess I'm a bit skeptical of the word hope.
Strike hope. That from the minutes.
Yeah. I'm about to say.
I'm trying to think about this testing thing. I mean,
some level of.
Because, you know, I see where you're going with it, but I mean, it's not like they're licensed. It's not like a licensure test. I mean, how would we figure out something?
That doesn't say you're competent.
Well, but at least it's like a standardized, reliable, valid instrument. I mean, I don't know if it would be, you know, it'd be, I'm just trying to think through this. I see your point. I don't know.
One of the things that I'm struggling with is in our new world order, there's certain things that are expected of providers. Mm-hmm. And from a provider's view, we want to see that the same level of expectation set is set for MCOs,
right,
that are overseeing the provider. So,
right.
So some kind of that they went through the training, that they have yet this to still go through, and they're being monitored under a supervision plan, and I think that ought to be a requirement.
I mean, some of the stuff on here obviously would be training, so if that be trains they could check off on. I mean, I don't know, are there thoughts about something besides the test that Rose has a thought? Oh.
I mean, I'm happy to respond whenever you'd like me to. I have some things I can say about that.
Do they ever seek out feedback from the individuals and families that are being served by the care coordinators? There could be, you know, like even the car dealer sends you
evaluation. Or like monthly supervisions, because I know like in the providers, APs are required to have monthly supervisions each month.
So I don't think we have a training of supervision requirement that we need to look at that. That makes sense.
I mean, I can speak to a lot of this, and I've been a part of the work group, and I think the intent of the document is really an effort to provide some guidelines and some structure to what you're trying to get to, Bob. We have not talked about a test or a certification. There has been some looking at some certifications that are out there in the world, but none of them really, they don't seem to quite be what they might be sold as being, right? I totally agree with you in terms of care coordinators being all over the map, just like we would experience that with providers, QPs, your direct care, everybody. I mean, it's just the nature of the business. So I really think if we look at this document as a framework, knowing that all, well, I can't speak for all MCOs, but MCOs that are accredited are required to have supervision plans, and that's a very formal process. Regular supervision based on what that person needs based on that plan. So, you know, some MCOs I think all MCOs, when they have new staff, they go through a training. Now, it may look, they go through trainings. They have a plan by which they try to address all the requirements in the waiver, all those other trainings, the person-centered planning, thinking, CQL, all of that stuff. It takes time, of course, you know. I think we probably all do it a little differently, and I don't know that we'll ever fix that. But I do think the document is really an effort to sort of put it all in one place and say these are the things that we think as a group and as a state and as this group represents, those things that are important that should be addressed. And see, the other magical part about this, what's not magical is, you know, it may need to be updated over the years, right? Because sometimes we create things and they get done and they get put away. And if you want to try to keep it somewhat standard, you would want to have a mechanism by which it was updated. So it's I think it's a challenge. I personally would not favor a testing situation. I don't think it really addresses the competency. Because I can go take a test today on something, but that doesn't mean I'm really competent. I think the competence comes through with that day-to-day work that care coordinator does, that supervisor looks at, to family satisfaction, that kind of thing. So, and provider satisfaction as well. I mean, we're not all about making providers happier, you know, but making sure that we are consistent and that we are doing things based on what that individual family have asked us to do.
So this is definitely a start. I agree with what Rose said. You know, competency tests is the, you know, I thought about it because on the person-centered thinking, I mean, for example, Chris Higgins done a lot of training on person-centered thinking. And for sure, he is able to evaluates what the competency at that part of the curriculum is. And that's all I'm saying is that there is some measure by which they have appeared to have gone through the training. And you can't ever say whether somebody, you can't measure knowledge. You have to see that, as Rose says, demonstrated over time. But there ought to be some measurement, and that we have greater oversight, the concept that I'm trying to get at, to greater oversight for the newbies than you would for the one that's been doing it for a decade and hopefully knows those things.
I was going to say, we don't make any assumption that somebody, just because they've done it for 20 years, they know everything and they do it right, because that doesn't always pan out.
Yes.
Right? Sometimes we've been doing something for 20 years and it may look like it's right, but it's really not. So you have to guard against that as well.
Right. I do try to be an old dog that does learn new tricks. But yes, sometimes you have young folks that are Understood, agreed.
So a couple of things I would like to just say about this, and something for, I guess, you guys at the state to consider, or us to consider, maybe as stakeholders. One of the things that I don't think this speaks to, and I have to admit I haven't read it thoroughly, is how specialized a care coordinator can be, or not. So in the old world of case management, I'm a case manager, I have 35 people on my caseload, and it's from 69 years old to 5. And it's everything in between, from MRMI to children with autism spectrum, TBI, cerebral palsy, medically fragile type, you know, every kind of thing in between. Well, nobody's going to be good at that. No matter how good they are, they're not going to be good at everything for every type of manifestation you could have in this very broad IDD definition. So at ECBH today and in our future entity, we are specialized adult and child. And
excellent.
In each of those care coordination groupings, they're either further specialized in autism spectrum, medically fragile, MRMI, or MHIDD, I'm sorry. Specialized to the extent that that's possible within the available staffing resources. So that when I have a care coordinator on the child team that is working with a five-year-old who has autism spectrum, at whatever place in the spectrum they may fall, their training can be really targeted at what happens with five-year-olds on the spectrum. So that when they're writing plans and developing resources with families, they have the ability to be able to not only have that discussion with other professionals that are specialized, physicians or OTs or PTs who treat that pediatric population, but also that's who everybody on their caseload is, right? And in a specific geographic region. And so, you know, you Medicaid has the power to delineate that kind of configuration in the LME MCOs that improves the quality of care for families as a result of having some specialty within, or subspecialty, I guess, within the specialty of care coordination and IDD.
Yeah, I'm looking at the last page of this, which is evidence-based practices and formal training and or MCO training in that section. We can talk about like some specialized training for your...
It's really more about how that gets designed based on your population. So that's a choice we made in ECBH. I don't know if any other MCO has chosen design their care coordination around that kind of a model. It's good clinical practice, right?
Smokey does it a little bit.
Yeah.
Well, that's exactly, Cindy got it exactly right. And if you transferred this, I guess, to the provider world, what we expect the providers stated is that they have experience with the population served. But so you have to kind of generic training that's pervasive, like this describes, in much of the document. And then at the end, it does get into a little bit of the specifics. But Cindy got exactly right. We do want to have care coordinators that have experience with the population that they're going to be serving and develop some level of expertise with that population.
Right. So our adults with MHIDD have the opportunity to staff cases with Diana Antonacci, who's very well-known MRMI, formerly psychiatrist. I mean, so it really makes a huge impact on the quality of care for those individuals because they have that opportunity to talk to a psychiatrist. That doesn't mean that we don't ever have issues, that those people don't experience severe crisis, but it's just a different approach all the way around. When you think of competency, Rose got it right. I mean, it's all about that supervision. But sometimes it's about design. And that's really more what I'm talking about, less about maybe the competency, more about how it's designed to support competency. You know, because if you give me a caseload of everything and anything under the sun, even though I'm a licensed professional, I'm not going to be great at all of them. I just can't know everything. And so I would just say that I think that's something, Medicaid could impose that through your contract with MCOs.
Cool. So can I make a final closing statement?
You're paying us.
Only because I think this is important, and I think that's a good recommendation. But I've done a lot of work, as Bob mentioned, in this area in terms of my own personal mentoring to be trained in a variety of models and to go through the observations to demonstrate the skill, which in the end really is the only way you're going to know. But I've been around a while, and in conversations, there is not a single person that I've met that wouldn't say they're person-centered. Everyone always believes they are, and to a degree they are, but when it comes to really understanding what that means and the impact on the family and the individual and the translation of that skill into the work, there's often a pretty big gap between what a person may believe and what they actually do. So just, I just want to continue to be really cognizant of, we have a lot of...
How would we be able to, you know what I mean?
Well, I think it goes back to here. I think in the providers, it's okay, knowing that we can only put so many parameters, I think the expectation here is exactly right. I just think it's more of a comment on, we struggle to implement this in a meaningful way. How do we keep moving that way so the consistency is better, the competence is demonstrated more, and it may be more of a comment for everyone rather than just here. So good, you have it here. How do we keep moving? How do we keep the importance of that very clear and see more expectations for translation into the actual actions behind it?
So maybe this is just something we can take back back to your group, obviously, but also all of your groups, just think about that a little bit more, maybe.
Well, the answer is, and I apologize for coming in late, so maybe I'm doing something I shouldn't, but in any system, when you create a system, you get what you incentivize. And a lot of times when problems arise, it isn't because we incentivize the wrong thing. I mean, it's what happened. We didn't intend to. What we did was we dangled a carrot out there, and people went after the carrot, not realizing that the carrot we dangled was the wrong carrot.
Right.
So the solution is a clear, very definitive definition of what person-centered thinking is and what it looks like, recognizable points, and then making sure that whatever is built in to support the system in terms of the waiver, the incentive, that incentive is pointing specifically and directly at those outcomes.
So, and well, maybe it's outcomes. Maybe that's what you're thinking about, Bob, actually. That might be the point. Because where we started at is that Bob was saying that these are all great expectations, but he'd like to see that there would be a test or a something to make sure people were actually... I don't think the test will work for various reasons.
Let me provide an example that might clarify what I'm saying. The system I came from had regional centers, which was a quasi-equivalent to the LMEMCO. Mm-hmm. It was a state, it was a nonprofit, 22 of them across the state, and each one was funded specifically 100% by the Department of Developmental Services, so it was 100% dollar coming down. The budget was divided by the administrative budget, which was for all the staffing, anything that needed to happen, and that was specifically separated from services, so it was two separate pots of money. It's a great idea, works. The intent was great. The problem was the incentive wasn't clarified, the points weren't clarified. So even though we were supposed to spend 100% of the money to provide the service, it was easy for the care providers and the service workers to sit back and say, what's the metric? The metric is, well, I've got these dollars, I gotta be careful with it. So we started seeing where people were cutting back on the money that was being spent. So the intent was correct. The carrot was dangled out there, but without clarifying what the outcome should have been, we ended up seeing exactly what we didn't want to see.
And part of what this group will be doing is going to be bringing back to you outcomes. So maybe that's where you're driving at, Bob. Because the other thing is if we the MCOs still have to, right, thank you. The MCOs still have to have some flexibility within their own system. You know what I mean? Okay, so these are our expectations. As I said, the group is working. I think Monica's going to bring it to another meeting. This is what you're actually looking to get out of it, which is maybe more important than any kind of a test. I don't know. Mr. Roland, do you have something to say?
Well, I was comments earlier in the discussion, we were talking about accountability, which is kind of the flip side of incentives. I think that no matter how long somebody's been doing this work, performance is not always going to be on the uphill. I think there should be in position a device to get feedback from the families and other advocates. It should be consistent. It should not be overly complicated. You could take a look at this and pull out those things that are going to be most important to those with these interests. Not the whole thing, but the care coordinators will know what's on that list. They'll know what the people they're serving are going to be providing feedback on. And that's another kind of incentive, even though it's...
Exactly what I'm talking about.
Right.
Too often we dangle the carrot without thinking, and usually it's, you know, you finish it quickly and we'll give you a bonus.
Right.
In this case, we're talking a different kind of incentive that the outcomes that we're talking about, redefine the outcomes, if that review that the parent and the family puts in is tied to the incentive, whatever that, and again, I'm using incentive in its broadest terms. It may be financial, it may not be. But if the incentive and the carrot is based and tied directly to those kinds of outcomes, then you begin to see what we're trying to do is harness human nature and point it in the direction we want it to go. Because human nature says, I'm going to go where I get the best benefit, the quickest benefit, and the easiest benefit. If we are saying that the quickest, bestest, easiest benefit is here, based on the rules we provide, then that's likely what you're going to get. If that's where clarity of definition, clarity of outcome becomes an issue, if that's one of the outcomes, that becomes part of the benefit.
Well, if this is a statewide expectation, then it should be a uniform, relatively uniform statewide tool that is used.
I think that Monica's got some meat to take back to her group. So the only other, yes ma'am.
I just wanted to add something. In California, we would have the regional center kind of be our care coordinator, and every year we have an IPP, which would be kind of a summary of all the services, and they'd always have a box just that said, are you happy with your care coordinator, or would you like a different care coordinator? And every time there was correspondence, at least once a year with a big review, and then maybe halfway through the year, there would always be that option to voice whether you wanted to stay with the care coordinator that you had. And I think it's not that difficult to integrate in either whenever they give out the CIS results or discuss services that are going to be provided through, you know, status or anything, just to insert that additional question and have the person indicate whether they want to keep the care coordinator that they have.
And it's going to require the first bullet, or the first sub-bullet, which is to educate people receiving those services on what the care coordinator is expected to do. Otherwise, they can't find the...
Yeah, if I don't know what they're supposed to do, and I'm expecting them to evaluate this, and they're expecting to do...
Yeah. So that's a critical point.
Great bullet.
Well, if there's some sort of a, like, just informational thing that says, you know, what your care coordinator can do for you, then they would know what the scope is. But a lot of it is personality, or they just don't think that the person's working for them, or they're not knowledgeable enough, or whatever. I just think they should always be given the opportunity in a very routine manner to voice in at least twice a year that whether they want to stay with this person.
Or by exception. If something egregious happens that they think
Right. But I mean, just kind of sneak it in there. Each time they're like, yeah, you know, then they think about it. Am I happy with this person? Yeah, I'm pretty happy. But if I'm not happy, sometimes they might not call and say, I'm not happy. Maybe they don't know who to call, or maybe they think they'd have to call the care coordinator. Mm-hmm. So they would need to know, one, who you would call, what the procedure would be if there was like a situation where you needed to rat out your care coordinator immediately without going to the care coordinator. And then there should be like a really non-threatening, just completely common that sneaks in with every evaluation that just says, hey, you want to stay with your care coordinator.
So I'm going to move this along because I have other things to get through. The one other
thing. Come on. I filed a formal grievance twice. Still have the same care coordinator.
Well, so, and we'll talk about what we're
That's how bad this is.
Going forward. Do we still need the snap in here?
Until everybody has the snap?
Yeah.
The snap until everybody has a CIS.
Well, by the time this waiver goes into place, everyone should have a CIS.
Not necessarily. Not
the
children.
Okay. The children, I'm working on a contract with AIDD to finish off the children for me.
So,
what method?
That perhaps came out a little wrong, but we should have the children.
Let me rewind and tape over that.
SNAP until SIST.
Yeah. And I think that there, because some of these are more headings.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But great discussion, and we would definitely take this back to you. Thank you all. And I am going to kind of move along because we do have some other things to get through. The next few slides are talking about the ISP development, and this is a training done as part of the new employee orientation with the MCO. So it comes through orientation and through supervision, that ongoing supervision. And if you notice the last bullet on here, remember we kept talking about, you know, SIST is not the only tool, so we wanted to make sure we still listed that again. We're looking at the development of that ISP that you're going to be looking at more than just SIST. The first bullet on the next slide reviews utilization of service reports and provides annual statement of utilization to beneficiaries. I don't think everybody is doing that now. I think that has come up in the stakeholder group. I think it was, we called it EOB, an explanation of benefits, so to speak. So we listed it here. On the next slide, we have demonstrated a unified ISP approach. So, you know, researching, including, is not just, you know, the services that they're looking at, but say the person is also getting some mental health services. All that should be unified into that one planning session. It shouldn't be divided out because it's one.
Not what happens.
Develops those long-range outcomes and reports progress of provider, monitors the provider reported progress towards the short-term goals that are currently now being done by those providers. Again, incorporating the SIST into the ISP, you know, we have a separate document for that, and we'll go over that and go over the additional language that's been added into that document. And then kind of an overview of the innovations waiver. And this is completed by the MCO at the new employee orientation. And so, you know, the care coordinator needs to know things about level of care and the risk assessment and the service definitions. I mean, really the service definitions, because, you know, if there's a need, the care coordinator is kind of there to help guide and see what service really fits that need. Monitoring the services, and this can happen in a few ways, face-to-face, telephonic documentation, incident reporting, records management, and then self-direction. You know, that's a big one, and we want to see more of that happening, but that's now with the agency of choice. And I think most of the MCOs are now on board with their employer record, or at least gearing up for that. They had 2 years post-go-live date as an MCO to get that started. So this concludes my section of the slides. Do you have any questions? If not, I'll turn it over to Lisa.
Good job. Hello, everybody. Continuing on with more training, resource allocation. This will be formal training and MCO supervision. We will update this section as the resource allocation model is more fully developed. We're also looking at training under this regarding individual budgets, base budgets, and the add-ons. And the add-ons would be, of course, things like home modifications or vehicle adaptations. In regards to the UR policy, the UM work group is working on this and tackling that. We will be looking at preparing and sharing information with families about resource allocation and the individual budgets and why there is a need for resource allocation and how the different levels are determined.
Lisa?
Yes.
Are we going to, you mentioned the UR policy that that group is working on that. When are we going to see that information?
As it does,
So we brought the UM policy before and passed the basic policy plus policy.
Still, staff policy. Thank you.
Quick question. I don't know if this fits here necessarily, but I'll bring it up here and maybe we addressed it. But Ellen Perry and I were talking earlier today, and she wanted to be here, but she couldn't be and asked me to kind of pass along a recommendation. It has to do with eligibility and budgets and how things can change for someone depending on what may happen in their life. So I'm just going to go through the very quickly kind of what she really wanted to be sure to make a point about. So I'm making sure that the care coordinator can be a support to those receiving services when it comes to continuing to understand Medicaid and eligibility requirements and how things might change along the way. So an example would be if something changes in a person's life. In her case, a parent died. All of a sudden, she's receiving some additional resources, didn't see it coming, impacted her eligibility. She has a spend down or she has other things that come into place that actually result in a brief loss of Medicaid and a lot of disruption in services that she had been providing or receiving, and how to manage, how to potentially anticipate but manage through that. So obviously that would be more than the care coordinator, but there's a recognition of the need to be prepared for things.
That'd be like Medicaid 101, I guess.
Yeah, maybe it fits
the best you can.
I think what happens is sometimes
I'll be honest with you, I couldn't. I don't even know if I could do such a thing,
yeah,
truly, because there's so many intricacies that sometimes you don't. I don't know if you could fully be prepared for everything.
Maybe it's sensitivity to the fact that it happens and being prepared to help. I think that's really what I was hearing for her. And she had success with her care coordinator helping her navigate that, but it was pretty disruptive during that time.
Yeah.
And she was really wanting to say, heads up, this happens. How can we do a better job of anticipating potentially and then maybe heading off some of the
Well, and unfortunately, some of the stuff that you have to do, like when you go through SSI or what have you, it's bureaucracy. I mean, it is what it is. I hear it, but somebody to support you through it.
And really have the knowledge to navigate it as rapidly as possible, to support the mm-hmm. person to navigate that.
Well, thank you for bringing that up, Chris. Okay, we'll also have the CIS 101 formal training that would be provided by the MCOs, and that again is to give a basic understanding of the CIS and help people to know what to expect in a CIS interview. And I think that came up a lot in the focus groups and the listening tours that went on earlier around the state. Our next slide involves CQL, Personal Outcomes Measures, and this is the Council on Quality of Leadership. And again, this is just one type of tool to use in addition to the CIS. You know, we've spoken before how the CIS is not the only thing that needs to be used, but looking at other tools, and this is one of them, or any other promising practice personal outcome tool. Okay. The next slide on motivational interviewing or similar training. Motivational interviewing is used to facilitate and engage motivation within the individual in order to change their behavior. So it's a very focused, very goal-oriented kind of interviewing. And we feel like this would be helpful for the care coordinators to help them, again, with different principles and theory of change. And learning really the foundations of this type of interview.
So that considers the core, one of the core competencies?
That's what she said. Yes.
You don't like it or you don't like it, you hate it?
It seems a little, fluffy. But I guess it could be important.
Motivational interviewing?
And I don't really understand what it is.
It's
best practice service.
Yeah.
But it does, it motivates the individual being served
toward change or toward progress or toward whatever, you know, whatever goal they've identified for themselves.
It's a pretty best standard.
Writing the plan.
Writing well, and as they move through the plan.
But this is training the care coordinator how to do it.
So there's techniques to motivational interviewing that are in a there's a curriculum to help train people to develop those skills.
And it's a focused kind of interviewing. So Kathy, wouldn't you say it's to help a care coordinator ascertain better through interviewing questions and asking maybe guided questions or specific questions to get at somebody's level of need or what they need?
In order to write the plan, not to change the...
Well, it does say that, when they say behavior change, they're talking about what they want to change. I mean, not to do what we think you want to do.
So it sounds like all of the meetings that a care coordinator would have with the individual or the family would be based on this methodology.
I can speak a little bit to why this is in here. I think motivational interviewing is really, it's intended, and the clinicians in the room will correct me if I'm wrong, it's really a tool that's most often used for people that are receiving MHRSU services.
Yeah.
But many of the MCOs have found and or developed training that's tailored after the motivational interviewing model that really kind of assists the care coordinator with learning about sort of some of those basic foundational skills of when I'm interacting with you for the first time, having a better sense of sort of where you are in accepting the conversation, having any willingness to listen to me, or to be open to, I'm making this very general, so I apologize. But so it's not that the care coordinators are going to be practicing motivational interviewing. I think from the MCO's framework, it was an effort to give them some additional skills in understanding when they're talking to families and individuals and providers and other stakeholders, some of those things that those interactions and how those interactions may occur. I don't know if I'm explaining that well at all.
Just to build on your analogy there, that's exactly what it is. Any clinician's tool in your toolbox to help with the process.
If it's important and it will make the plan better.
Yeah.
I just didn't quite see how it was going to impact the very sort of one time we meet and do a,
issue. Right.
Okay, I didn't want, I mean, that's
but
fine.
I got you.
It just seemed like a long list. It had something like that in there. I was quite interested.
The question raises for me the question having to do with the title of the document, recommended competencies. Would there be value added if someone were to go through and determine which of each subset are required competencies?
Because I used to report, didn't I? These aren't required, these are just recommended.
Because there is a subset of required competencies.
They're absolutely required. I defer to your
Is this actually a part of the waiver, or is this a separate document?
It will be.
It's going to be added to the waiver. Okay.
In some fashion. Maybe not just exactly we'll have to speak to care coordination and our expectations in the waiver. Yes.
Yeah, because I can't think of what section anything like this is currently in the waiver. Okay, good.
Yeah.
I just wanted to clarify. Thanks.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. We'll take that back. Okay, once the use of assist is fully implemented, the SNAP will no longer be required.
So I jump ahead.
Want to get to that one now? Okay.
I don't know.
I agree.
Okay, with Medicaid overview.
That's how you really
feel. Let's take a vote.
Completed via the MCO, the new employee orientation and supervision should provide the Medicaid overview training. This will be monitoring the Medicaid enrollment of the individual and helping the care coordinator learn how to assist with maintaining Medicaid enrollment as needed.
So that's Chris's.
Yeah.
And I'm starting to say that's Chris's. Yeah, that's it.
I jumped ahead.
We're overachievers.
So thank you, Chris and Helen. Tell them we appreciate it. Okay. The next slide, we're trying to continue in notifying, helping the care coordinator notify the LME or MCO finance department of changes again in the individual monthly liability to keep their benefits still in going with Ellen's comment and concern. Also notifying DSS for DMA or DMH of any other changes in waiver enrollment for the individual. And again, this could be death or relocation or hospitalization more than 30 days or loss of their coverage. In terms of training around EPSDT, which is early and periodic screening, diagnostic, and treatment services, this is a federal Medicaid requirement that requires the state agency of DMA to cover services, products, or procedures for any Medicaid beneficiary that's under 21, if the service is medically necessary. So there would need to be training on that. Going on to the next slide, integrated care training. This would include an overview of existing care management organizations, and we've got a list there. Community Care of North Carolina, CMT, CMS, CMS is Case Management Information Systems. And this is a actually a secure web application for people that use the CCMC networks. Also, with this training, there would need to be the demonstrated ability to access data from these different organizations for the clients served, and incorporate this data into service planning and monitoring, and also consulting with other professionals and medical health teams. The next slide deals with training on individuals with comorbid mental health or behavioral health disorders. And this training could involve a familiarity with PBSPs. And I learned today that that refers to positive behavior support plans, which is like a reward system, where it plays more on an individual's strengths and abilities, as opposed to a system that would be more punitive or negative. Also, use of psychotropic meds and being familiar with community resources. The next slide relates to crisis planning and trauma-informed care. This training would educate about crisis service options and incorporating those things into a crisis plan. Like when the individual would need to go to a hospital, when mobile crisis would need to be contacted, NCSTAR or respite, and also positive identity development.
Question.
Okay.
I think this would be the place where you would, human rights committees and rules on supervision restraint, this kind of gets out in the earlier areas. Somewhere they need to have knowledge of what the expectations are for LME MCO, Human Rights Committee, or those run by providers.
Diagnostic specific training would relate to TBI, autism, or intellectual developmental disabilities. DSM-4 training would I put the eye there, there wasn't even one there. Sorry.
DSM, just a very picky thing, but it should be the number 5, not the letter B.
Okay, so DSM-5, the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual training would relate to different diagnostic codes that would be used.
I'm assuming that's just a couple of examples from the diagnostic.
Yes. The next slide about cultural diversity and sensitivity training. This would be training that helps individuals to recognize diversity and strength in culturally driven parenting styles and approaches to discipline. And this training would also help the coordinators learn how to link people to culturally relevant community resources. OK. Okay, the next slide about conflict resolution and formal training. This would be a skill set that would be regarding educating people about planning options without denying them to request what they feel is necessary in terms of their services, how to manage conflict productively and with respect, how to demonstrate active listening and setting professional boundaries, and modeling principles of teamwork. The next slide would be about is about training and guardianship and supporting decision making, adoption, power of attorney, living wills, and advanced directives. And this would help the individuals learn how to be familiar with methods of evaluating the effectiveness of the services, and also end of life decisions. And the last slide.
Can I just jump in on the supporting decision making for a second?
Okay.
So it is specifically an intentional process, and we're getting a lot of national effort in this area as an approach to something other than some more restrictive options. So I think it's great that that's in there. I think we have work to do to be sure we're determining methods to do that well and somewhat consistently then.
Yes.
I may be misunderstanding you, Ms. Ford, but evaluating the effectiveness of services, methods to do so, regarding guardianship, power of attorney, living wills, are we looking for paralegal skills here? Or I'm not sure the relationship between the dark bullet and the one right below it. Who is going to be evaluating the effectiveness of a given power of attorney?
I don't think that's what you guys are trying to say.
I guess I'm asking for clarification.
I mean, I'm just saying that, but I don't think that's what, Rose.
Yeah, I think, and when I was just reading it, it was twisting my brain up too, and I've read it too many times already, but it's really about helping care coordinators understand all of those different issues around guardianship or supporting people who may or may not have a guardian to still be empowered to express their degree of satisfaction, and the care coordinators should be able to, you know, support them if they have a guardian or if they don't, to make changes in services. That's a real tricky area, especially when people have guardians, because sometimes the choices an individual may make may be different than what the guardian wants for that person. And there should, in most cases, I mean, it's a person-by-person thing, but you want care coordinators to understand that and to be able to respect that and help teams, because the team really should help the person, the family, the guardian, help make decisions. Absolutely, in a lot of cases, the guardian has the last say, but, you know, there's some things in people's lives that guardians may or may not really have a say over, or may choose to negotiate sort of with the individual, the team. Again, it's a very individualized kind of thing. Did that help at all?
What Rose is saying is like there would be a general knowledge of, right? I mean, they're not expecting them
right,
to be
they're
expert
not, yeah.
at this. This is a complicated subject, and you wouldn't want to have in there implying that they would be, right?
If a client were to say, I want to talk about third-party power of attorney, the first thing the care coordinator should do is to pull out a list of potential lawyers that they could talk to.
Exactly.
Not get into any deep water there.
Right.
Well, a lot of times, that's why I was late. I was at the North Carolina Guardianship Providers Association meeting, which is going on simultaneously. And when clerks of the court have found that this person cannot make those decisions on their own for a variety of reasons, that is no longer under the MCO's funding mechanism. I mean, that guardianship was taken out of there a year ago and taken away from, for whatever reasons. Now it's under DAAS. But those two people, the services that we're providing are coming in direct connection to people that are doing the guardianship, and spending some time talking about informed decision making, which is really where I think the whole thing is going, changing how we provide those supports, putting in as least restrictive environment as possible. I'm hearing a lot of the same language that we're talking here over there. And so having that understanding and spending some time doing that training, I think, is kind of critical, because otherwise you're going to run into some problems where I have the final say in this is how it's going to be, and you have a problem with it, take it up with the clerk of the court.
Yeah, we need to. So, thank you.
Okay, and the last slide is, of course, training about HIPAA and confidentiality, ethics, evidence-based practices, and due process, and other training might include money follows the person training. Any questions on that section?
Basically, your care coordinators are never going to get to work because you're going to be in orientation for the entire time.
No, I think this is good.
The concept there, though, I think that is important is, yes, that is correct. But the advice would be focus on the core competence, differentiate between core competencies, which have to be in place. This is how providers have to think about, right? That have to be in place before you go on the job. And then other specific things you can get over time, and that's why the importance of that supervision plan to say, your specialty, back to Cindy's point, that's really what we're seeking, is that people develop an expertise for the population they're going to be serving. Well, and then you got to get the piece that's specific to the individual clients on your caseload.
Yeah.
And that's really three different kinds of...
But what this really shows me is a maturation process for us, because we didn't have it at the beginning because we didn't know. So, and this is exactly what this was, I think, needed. And I think it was well thought through. I think this group did a good job, but just mostly as we're moving along, the system's maturing. It really is. I think this is a sign.
So another thing just to consider that Bob would bring up if we were talking about providers is how is it paid for? Okay, because you're right. It wasn't considered the first time around. It wasn't factored into rate setting. And it probably isn't a cost covered by the current administrative amount. So it's just something you got to talk about, right?
Yeah.
And this group of people that did this work aren't finance people. They're clinical program people. So they don't talk about money. I bet it never even came up. How many hours is it? What's the resources in terms of human cost, expense? We're going to send them away, we're going to bring it here, who's going to foot the bill, or you, or my, who? So all of that is great, but it costs money and time.
Yeah, you're right.
And that has to be paid for by somebody. So, okay? So in the data book where you give me, however many care coordinators, I got to have however many people managing them, right down to the human resources staff that are saying, oh, by the way, that ethics training is up. You got to take it in. Whatever, and I realize it's guidelines, that's a little bit more loose versus, and I'm not asking for it to be prescriptive, but whatever it is, it has to be paid for.
Well said.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard you say that so many times, I just parroted you.
I believe it. I think it's
solid. Basically,
if you expect a function, the system expects functions performed, you have to pay for those functions.
Any other comments on this today? I mean, of course, I anticipate that we'll get lots of stuff into Renee in the next little bit. But anything else today? So we're going to move on to the CIS assessment tools, a document that I think you have in front of you also.
So this is our third review of this document, and on the second review, I think what was asked was additional information on the SU verification and about the training and ongoing training for CIS interviewers. So if you look in the third paragraph on the first page, we did add some additional language about SU verification. And if you had a chance to already read through it, just kind of want to get your feedback on, do you think it's enough? We have a lot more than this, but we thought it was taking the document in a different direction. And that's why we added the sentence, for additional information on supplemental verification, please contact your LME NCO.
Monica, I'm sorry, but I did not have time to read this one, truthfully.
Really, Mom?
And if you could be just a little bit more specific on these areas so I can find them.
Okay.
Because I did read it before.
Right.
But I hadn't read this version.
Okay. So on the first page, in the third paragraph where it starts, in addition, yep. North Carolina, I think, and I'm sorry, I did not bring the old version with me, so I don't know exactly where we started the new information. I think we may have had two or three sentences about SQ verification. So we just added some additional language in that section there, in that third paragraph on page one. And it talks about, you know, the SQ verification is a committee formed by the LME MCO to look at those supplemental questions and to gather that documentation to support that information that's showing up. So I just want to know if that was clear enough in this document. Just wanted your feedback. Yes,
so I'm not sure if it fits in this section of the document or maybe in the using the system planning portion, or maybe it's captured back in the care coordination responsibilities. But Mary and I have been talking, and there's a fair amount of districts still for families around. So what is the verification process, and really what does that mean? How might that impact our life? And it can be pretty wide. And I think there are lots of questions out there. And I think we ought to figure out a way that we somewhere, I don't know if it's right here, but because we're on the SIS, that we're trying to understand that and do more or find ways to be more consistent in how to explain what that means and what the potential impact would be. In some cases, there may be very little impact in terms of the overall process of what planning that might take place. In some cases, it recognizes an additional need someone might have, and we know that, and it means that there's a need for additional services, even if the score is lower. We know those things. Well, I'm not sure how well that's being translated out. And I think somehow it would be good to be thinking about that.
So more of how does this really work?
I want to make sure. I think I'm capturing this from some experience that I have, but I do want to make sure I'm not
right.
missing a component here.
The problem has come up in that, in Smoky, the SIS Verification Committee in June of 2013 reviewed the November 1st, 2012 plan of care when the SIS was performed November 19th. So the November 1st, 2012 plan of care was not written and didn't contain documentation about the SIS supplemental questions because the SIS wasn't performed until after. So Katie wasn't informed that the SIS verification committee invalidated the answers to those questions. But they looked at the wrong plan. If you're going to use the SIS, I mean, somehow we as families, when you get your SIS, you need to make sure that the very next plan of care that you write, that every single one of those answers is in your plan of care. If you have to add narrative page after narrative page after narrative page, everything, just as in the risk assessment, if you've identified a risk and you didn't put it in the narrative of your ISP, it will impact probably your budget, it'll impact your score. And if your care coordinator doesn't know to do that, you're in deep trouble, as we are.
It took us a minute there to follow you, but we got you now.
Right. I mean, so in September, we meet to submit the plan October 1st to be approved November 1st. November 19th, she has her SIS. June of the following year, the SIS Verification Committee looks back at that November 1st approved plan. Well, duh, it's not in there. But they didn't contact us in June of 2013. If you think the plan doesn't, well, ask, you weren't at the SIS, ask the people.
So, okay. So are you done with this piece? Anything else on this piece?
Well, yeah, ask you, not unless there are additional feedback or questions. Okay, so the other thing that we updated was at the end of page one, I think we had one sentence, maybe, about the that the SIS is administered by an AAIDD trained SIS evaluator or SIS interviewer, and the feedback was, that's not enough, that's not telling us anything, okay, they're trained. What is the ongoing training? How did they get trained? So we added some additional language.
Oh, wow, look at that.
We talked about the three phases of the of the training. And then we talked about, you know, once they are trained, that ongoing training and the percentage they have to maintain to continue to provide or do those SIS assessments. So
85%.
How
are
those intent?
Very nice.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. Thank you all.
Yeah, all right. Good job, Monica. So then, there we go. You want to leave back here to 35 after?